Trash, Part 2, Chapter 1. My name is Father Julliard, and I'm the one pulling these accounts together. All names changed for obvious reasons. You will understand the importance of this at the end, but it's a story that had to be told. The next set of events is best left to me and to one of my former staff. I will just tell you that I've been running the Pascal Agueda Mission School on the Bahala dump site for 7 years. It was going to be a one-year job. My task was to set it back on its feet after some financial mismanagement. It was to be my final posting. I'm 63. But I fell in love with the place, and I've been here ever since. Unfortunately, I am being retired this year, partly because of this story. The school has already appointed its new head, and my final office task is the handover. Final official task is the handover. I hope to stay in the country, but I'm not sure I can. I should say, by the way, that our school does need new energy, as we've been getting smaller rather than larger. It's hard to keep the children attending class. We have to bribe them with food. Our income's going down, and the food resources are never regular. It's also so hot, and around the dry season, it gets stifling. The school is made of large metal boxes, the iron containers you see on ships and trucks. 10 were donated to start the mission. They were bolted together and windows and doors were hacked out. There it was, an instant metal school. 6 more crates were bought and they made the upstairs. 2 form a chapel. 3 have been knocked together for a baby's room with a little play area in one corner. Half of one is a rest area and the other half is my office. I only knew Raphael and Gardo by sight as they rarely came to classes. Few children do after the age of 10. Their families want them picking trash, and it's hard to argue that education's ever going to be helpful, so we lose them. Little June, the boy they call Rat, I knew better. He would visit me in my office, sneaking up when the other children had gone, climbing the outside like a monkey. I'd let him in through a window, I'd give him the ointment and plasters he needed, and if he wanted one, I'd let him take a bath. I would have to give him food, too, because he was evidently starving. We had a rule that food was only provided at lunchtime and for half an hour after classes. I broke that rule for June and a handful of others like him because I've always said that you have to break the rules. I set rules up and then I break them. Sister Olivia broke the rules as well, as you shall hear. Don't put your feet on the chairs. Don't take more food than food for you. Don't take food out to your family. Stay in line. Say the prayer quietly. Wear a shirt when you're indoors. Wash your feet before chapel. I have to laugh at myself, but rules are what we live by, even though we all know they're sometimes foolish. One rule I like a lot, though, is an unusual one. On the stairs up to chapel, nobody must speak. Why can't you speak on the chapel stairs? Let me tell you, somewhere it is relevant. The steps in the chapel are dedicated to the man whose name we bear, Pascal Agueda, one of the county's lesser known freedom fighters. The Agueda family donates a large sum of money every year, and they bought those last 6 containers for our upstairs. They ask that we honor Pascal's memory, which is a pleasure as well as a duty. He was a man who fought corruption and was shot to death for his pains. So we honor him several times a day, just by being quiet on the stairs. I find that the children never need reminding. Just now and then, if there's a boy or girl who's new, they might be chattering. Then you hear a great deal of shh, like a breeze, and everyone is silent. We tell them about Pascal, of course, and his picture hangs over the altar. He was a man determined to build things and make life better. He spoke a dozen languages. Yet he was from a poor family. He became a lawyer, but he continued to live in a poor quarter of the city. He took on impossible cases and won them. When squatters had their houses bulldozed, Pascal Agueda forced the government to find them land. When a building project hired 1,000 men and failed to supply them with boots, gloves, or hats, Pascal Agueda sued and forced a change in the law that made the construction industry a whole lot safer. When cholera hit the swamps, just up from the docks, Pascal Agueda forced the local hospital, a private concern for the paying rich, to set up a special unit for the poor. His final act, the one that killed him, was to expose three senators who'd been siphoning off public taxes and stowing them offshore. They all resigned, and the prosecution rumbles on. Pascal Aguirre was shot to pieces in a taxi on his way to testify. 26 bullets, the same caliber as a policeman's gun, and his murderers were never found. I sometimes sit on the stairs under the plaque we had made, and I think about this brave man. It is by such small things, small as a silent staircase, that the dead live on and help us. In this country, the dead are very important. You want to know how I was part of Raphael's tale, of course, and what I did. I was on the edge only. Sister Olivia, our temporary house mother, was more crucial and perhaps more foolish. But I got involved because of the school computer, which was donated by the RCBC Bank. We score these little successes. We get our foot in the door. You won't think me uncharitable, I hope, when I confess that the computer was old and out of date, and if they hadn't given it to us, it would have ended on one of those trash heaps. Who cares? They gave with a good heart, I think, and we've had much use out of it. It connects to the internet, and the children play games on it when I let them. It was a Thursday afternoon when June came by, with the two boys I hardly knew. "Sir Poe," he said. "Sir Poe?" He's got this high-pitched, musical little voice, and I recognized it instantly. I turned and smiled. He was leaning in my office door. He's as thin as a match and the color of ash. He has a smile that makes me smile, too, and I'm always pleased to see him. "We're looking for something, Poe." Poe, by the way, is a word of respect people use here for their elders. Can we use the computer, Sir Poe?" I told him it was late. Then I looked beyond him and saw he had two friends with him, slight, skinny boys. One looked shy and the other looked watchful. You could see at once who the leader was. His head was shaved and his eyes didn't blink. He had long arms and even with the poor diet he had, the poise, the grace of an athlete. The other one had long hair over his face and another enchanting smile. "Poe, Sir Poe, this is Gardo." He pointed at the boy with the shaved head. "This is Raphael. Do you know them?" I told him I didn't, but was pleased to, and we all shook hands. "They're taking part in a quiz," said June. "It's a newspaper thing, sir. They have to research, sir. They said they don't come to school here, so why would you help them? So I said I'd come. They can give money for the computer time, okay? I said, maybe you would, Poe?" I told them to come in, and they came over to my desk. Shorts and t-shirts, bare feet, black right up to their knees. Their smell filled the room. The one called Raphael looked at me, pushing his hair back, too shy to make eye contact. He held a 20 peso note in both his hands for computer time. Gardo stayed behind him, and I could feel him staring right at me as if he might have a fight. "I'm afraid the connection's slow today," I said. I put a second chair by the computer and waved away the boy's money. They slid onto the chairs, and Raphael got straight down to work. Children always know how to use computers. It never fails to amaze me. Children who'd never stepped inside a classroom could work a keyboard faster than me. It was the game shops where they learned, of course. For 10 pesos, you could get 15 minutes of shooting and chasing. I saw him go straight to a search engine, and the bald boy opened a piece of paper. Raphael tapped in a name, and we all watched as the computer thought long and hard. I said, "What have you eaten today, June?" He smiled up at me and held my arm. "Nothing," he said proudly. I went down to the kitchen and made some sandwiches. I got three glasses too and filled them with lemonade. By the time I got back, the boys were chattering in low, excited voices, scrolling down the screen and pointing. They'd called up a local news site and were reading carefully. "What's the question?" I said. They looked blank. So I said, "For your quiz, what question are you answering?" Raphael said, "It's about history, sir." Then he was talking in his own language, which I am ashamed to say I hardly speak, despite the length of time I've been out here. The second boy, Gardo, was shaking his head. Whatever they were looking at seemed to be a serious business. June, meanwhile, took a sandwich in hand that was so dirty it made me wince. The boy bites his nails right down to the quick, and his fingers remind me of skeletons. He promises and promises to come to class, but he so rarely does. He must have the strangest mix of ideas from the ones he's attended. It's become a joke between us. I always say, "So, you'll be in school tomorrow?" He assures me that he will, and I know he won't. I will never forget the sight of him the first time he took a shower here. He had a towel wrapped around himself and was dancing with the cold and the excitement of the spurting water, and maybe the amazement of seeing his own flesh looking clean. I gave him one of our school uniforms, but I never saw him wear it. Sister Olivia fell in love with him too and asked me about adoption. A 22-year-old girl from England wanting to adopt. I told her not to think of it. The machinery for adoption out here is slow, for one thing. In 6 years, I've known one successful case for a foreigner. No government is going to give away its children. I understand that, and yet you look around at the thousands who cannot be taken care of, and it breaks your heart. You look at the mountains of garbage and the children on them, like so much more garbage. And it's easy to think what you do in a school like this of absolutely no consequence or good to anyone. More and more children. When I walk around the shanties, I see the babies, and I'm always asked to hold them. And while we're smiling and laughing, I'm thinking in the back of my mind, this tiny child, as soon as it can crawl, it will be crawling through trash. The boys finished on the computer soon after I came back with the tray, and they turned and had a sandwich, drank their lemonade. They were polite, as the children here always are, but they wanted to go. I said, "So, school tomorrow? All three of you?" June laughed, "Definitely." Raphael said, "I want to come, Pope, but I'm working." He pushed his hair back and smiled his dazzling smile. I reminded him that he could work and also do a morning class. I reminded him that the school was set up for exactly that purpose, to let the children work while providing education. If they attended 5 days, they get 2 kilos of rice and a few bits and pieces extra, depending on what's been donated. That is the incentive. Raphael looked at me, and I wondered if he was thinking that obvious thought. And what use is an education to me? He said, "I will come, Po." Then June took the plate and glasses into my kitchen. He insisted on washing them and setting them in the drying rack. Then he gave me a hug, and I slipped him 50 pesos. The other boys were waiting for him outside, and they ran away together. I never saw them again. It was a few weeks later that I discovered they'd been lying. There had been no quiz, of course. They were finding out everything they could about Mr. Jose Angelico, the man whose ID they'd found. They had also been researching Gabriel Alondras, who at the time was serving his 23rd year in the city's biggest prison. Rat had been up to something too, which he will reveal in due course. They had all got what they wanted and had deceived me beautifully.